Welcome to Documentary First, an inside look at a first-time filmmaker's journey. I'm your host, Josh Lindsay, from the Movie Proposal Podcast. And with me is our first-time filmmaker, Christian Taylor.
Hey there.
Hey there.
Long time to talk to you.
Long time no talk. And next to Christian, as always, because otherwise you wouldn't be listening to this, is our sound guy, research extraordinaire, pushing buttons, Jason Rugg.
Hey there.
Were you going to say something?
I like his cute little hey there. He kind of sounds like a Muppet.
A quiet Muppet, I guess.
Isn't that like an insult in England?
No.
Like, you Muppet?
Oh, is it?
I don't know if you call somebody a Muppet.
I think it's a backhanded compliment is what it is.
Yeah.
Speaking of English people, I'm totally going off the record here, but guess what I did last night?
Went to England.
Nope, but I was talking to a man from England, which made me think of this. I was at Cantini, and they had a Band of Brothers evening.
Oh.
And I hung out with Frank Perconti, Ramirez, Gonzalez, and Dukeman.
What do you mean you hung out? Like, were these people portraying those people?
Yeah, those are the actors.
Oh.
And one of the writers.
Wow.
It was super cool.
Oh, my goodness.
I mean, I'm already friends with a couple of them because they're in Normandy.
Did you get some pictures, post stuff?
Yeah, you want to see?
Well, I mean, not be kind of a lame thing to do on a podcast, I suppose. But
yeah, well, I guess
can
we'll
post them.
So that's Douglas Spain.
Wow.
He played Tony Gonzalez. That's
these are amazing pictures. I wish our listeners
this
could see
Dukeman
them.
This is Dukeman and Ramirez.
They look exactly what you think.
Just yes, people. They're just look like people in a, and that's Frank Perconti. He still looks very much like
he
used to.
Oh, I totally recognize that guy. He's in a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
Did you call any of them a Muppet?
I did not call them a Muppet. Sorry, everybody. I guess I'll have to post those on my Facebook page.
Yes.
Anyway, it's a super fun night. They're awesome guys. If you ever have a Band of Brothers opportunity to go and meet them, I highly suggest you do. They took a lot of time to talk with people and, you know, sign autographs and take pictures. They were awesome guys.
Speaking of taking pictures and posting them, you have a book with... would you call it a photo book?
Well, it does have archival photos, some personal photos of Danny's, and then other ones that we found. But yes, I mean, Jason didn't even know we had a book. I think you even said to me, there's a book? Yes, there is a book, The Girl Who Wore Freedom. It was written by Peggy Sue Wells and I together. She did a lion's share of the work because she is an actual author. She did an incredible job because I think she had to work on this soup to nuts to figure out how we self-published this book. And we just did a lot of research and, you know, I learned a lot about the book writing process from buying ISBN numbers to, you know, hiring graphic artists to lay it out to, we also translated it into French, so it's French and English. But you can find it on Amazon.com. You can find it, more importantly, you can find it on our website, normandystories.com/shop. If you buy it through our website, part of the proceeds come back to us. So, because we have an affiliate with Amazon.
Okay.
So that would be great if you would buy a book through our website. What does it cost, Jason? You've got Amazon up there, right there.
It costs $24.99 hardcover or $10.99 on Kindle.
Yes. So the most interesting thing about this is when I took 100 books to France. No, 50 books to France. 25 English, 25 French. They didn't sell. So I was like, oh, well, I guess this was a bad idea because I laid out a lot of the money up front. And then I had to leave most of them there because they were too heavy for me to bring home. But then I come here. I have a few left. I order some, you know, on Amazon myself, and I take them with me. And at the first screening in Chicago, people bought them. So I was like, huh, they sold better. I think we sold 5. And I was like, wow, they sold better here than they did in France. And at this point, we're not really making money, you know. We're
right.
Still, I'm not even charging really enough. So, when I was in Clarksville last week, somebody met me on a Tuesday night opening dinner and said, oh, you're the author of that book. And I was like, I was like, I've never been referred to as that, an author. I'm like, I am? And he's like, yeah, your book. I bought your book. And I was like, you bought my book? He's like, yeah, I brought it here to sign it. And
wow.
I was like, what? And so there were people that actually saw that I was going to be at the Welcome Home Celebration, bought the book so I would sign it.
Wow.
And that has started happening, which is super cool. So we did this originally because we wanted to capture her story, and we were trying to think about a way that we could make money for the film. What it has turned out being is that people actually really like the book. Like, it's a children's book. It's Danny's story. Mm-hmm. We also put a bunch of history in the back. But it's nobody's ever heard this story before. So it's a brand new story.
So, okay, you're a first-time filmmaker attempting to do something you've never done before that's difficult for professionals to do.
Yeah, that's true.
I'd like to point out we had a cricket just join our audience.
Where did that guy come from?
I have no idea.
He has a lot to say, apparently.
We shoot this in Phil Vischer's studio.
He's Bob the Tomato of VeggieTale fame.
Yes, and it has a professional look to it there's actually—
No, it doesn't. Yes, you're being way too kind.
No, I'm serious.
Well, if you don't look at it, it's very professional.
Well, I mean, there's a sound stage, and there's light. I mean, rafters, you know, lights hanging from it. You know, like, I mean, this is way more to do than— a typical podcaster's.
That's true.
You know, I mean, it's a mess in here too, I'll say that. But
wow.
But apparently
lots of years of lots of creative stuff happening in here.
Nature is creeping its way in.
Yes.
So okay, the cricket's gone. What were we talking about?
You were saying
the book.
The film. You were like,
yeah, you're attempting to do this seemingly impossible feat that you've never done before. Professionals have a hard time doing this, period. And then you decide to do a book on top of it. I mean, the book itself, like, I try and do these things for my family, and Dad, have you finished the movie yet? Have you finished the book yet? And you're like, no, give me, get off my back, kid, right?
Yeah.
I gotta have creative spurts to get me going.
You totally do, that's for sure.
But how'd you come up with the idea?
Well, really, it's out of desperation. I mean, you're thinking, what can I do? And really, I'm all in, right? Right now, I have the luxury of being all in. I have a husband that does put a roof over our head. My children are older. And I'm so passionate about this, and I've spent so much time and so much of my own personal money that I can't stop now. I'm over the Atlantic Ocean. If I stop flapping my wings, right, I'm going to crash into the sea, and I can't do that. So, I'm constantly, there is no question I have an entrepreneurial bent, and I think that's another thing that we need to say to anybody that is interested in being a first-time filmmaker, is you got to think outside the box, and I may have said this before, of I'm just making a film or I want to express my art. You have to think of it as a business. When you open a film, you are opening a business, and all the rules apply. It takes money to make money. You have to invest in time and capital in order to actually have something to then sell. You have to market, promote, fundraise, all of those things. And so I'm just always thinking outside the box, what else can I do? What else can I do? What else can I do? And partnering with people who I always know I have no idea what I'm doing, but maybe someone else will that will partner with me. And in that case, it's Peggy Sue Wells. She's an author. She's done this before. She, she was a dear friend of Katie Lee's, who is the voice of Connie on Adventures in Odyssey works with you in Primerica. Katie Lee introduced me to Peggy Sue Wells. And so she's like, well, let's try to do a book. This is a great story. Now, the next stage is for us to submit the manuscript to a publisher where we would have watercolor drawings and it would be a real children's book.
Okay.
For now, we just... It's very simple, totally bare bones, just black and white archival photos in the book and print. But the story...
Still a beautiful book.
It's a beautiful book, and the story is really great, and kids love it. So, I don't know. I have hope that maybe one day I'll recoup what I invested. I think I have invested like $2,500 or more in this book. But when I pay for the graphic art color, laying out the cover and the transcriptions and all the fees for everything, and then actually ordering the first two boxes of books and having them shipped to France and all of that, takes money. So I don't know if it'll, but I do know it's good marketing material.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So That's been good.
I was thinking, since I've heard that you published a book and I didn't, you know, like 10 minutes ago, I have friends and people I've known who are like, one of their dreams is to one day publish a book, even if it's self-published.
Yeah.
And so you kind of accidentally accomplished other people's dreams.
Yeah, that's true. That's so true. Like I never that, had a dream
by default, almost.
Yeah, so that's kind of cool. It's the things that come along with making a film that you never expect. And
yeah.
That's, like you said, you're thinking outside the box, but this is something that, you know, it's something that people try to do, and you've kind of accidentally found your way into this really cool little thing. That's
yeah, that was cool. that was really actually kind of cool. When he came up to me and said, "Oh, you're the author," I was like, "What? No, I'm not.
I'm a filmmaker. Have you heard of my movie?
Shame on you.
You're an auteur." Yeah.
Well, I think the thing that's interesting about this is that now in our society, not only can artists make their own book.
Yeah.
They can make their own film. Like, it truly is remarkable that I have been able to do this, you know,
well,
with
this
little training and money and everything
right.
that I have.
I just listening, Jason, you talk about, you know, friends who dream of even just self-publishing. It really, you know, you just got to do something.
Yeah,
you just have to start moving forward doing something. You know, when Sky was talking, we actually had Todd Kobernecki, the producer of Elf, and he talks, he gives a talk to college students who, you know, or want to be screenwriters and filmmakers. And he's like, look, I'll talk for the next 30 minutes, but I'm going to tell you right now, the whole crux of this is you have to leave here and you have to go home and you have to write. You just have to do it. And Sky, who's a published author, it just said, amen. Like, it doesn't matter if you have a publisher, if you have an idea, you just have to go home and write, and you have to do something. So it is a dream if you sit around and think about it and do nothing. But if you just go out and do something.
I mean, that's absolutely right. You have to just decide, I'm going to do it. And you have to step forward knowing that you can't see a foot in front of you, but you can see the next step.
Right.
And so you just have to do it and stop procrastinating, whatever that thing is, whatever it is. And, you know, like with this, yes, you can self-publish, but it still takes work.
Oh,
Peggy Sue will tell you if she was here. I never understood that it was this much work to actually get this done. And I don't know that she'll ever do it again. But but we did it together. And fortunately, because I've written a movie script and I've spent years researching Danny's life, we had all the materials. It was just a matter of crafting it and putting it together. That was honestly the easier part. It was just getting it actually done. So if you have not looked at The Girl Who Wore Freedom book, I highly recommend you do. Do we have any reviews on Amazon? I'm curious.
We do, actually. We have three different ones, but I'll just do this top one here. And it starts out with, please, can we have more books like this one? Our grip on World War II history is loosening with the passing of every veteran. This is a book that will help our children and grandchildren understand what was at stake in that conflict. And the images contribute so much to the story. A well-written and much-needed book. Highly recommend.
Wow,
that's awesome. That makes me super happy. I wonder if one day there'll be reviews for my film that I'll actually want to read.
Well, speaking of reviews, if you are listening to this podcast, you can review the podcast to help boost its, you know, awareness, you know, to other people. So,
and we actually just discovered that it's on iTunes with reviews. We didn't even know it.
I was asking earlier, how does one listen to this podcast?
We knew it was on iTunes, but we just had never looked.
Okay, well, you, Jason knew. I had no idea.
Yeah, so it's on everything you can listen to, you know, a podcast on: iTunes, Stitcher, Spotify, YouTube, our website.
And I also know that I'm the one that says welcome to Documentary First every time we do this. And I didn't search for that. I searched for The Girl Who Wore Freedom. And it's actually called Documentary First.
Yes. Documentary
Maybe that's,
First.
It's should, obvious to everyone but me.
We should probably add that to the tags.
Oh, the things you learn. Yeah, how not to do a podcast.
Right.
Anyway, so, well, maybe the next podcast, you can read me some of those comments because curious as to what they say. Well, listen, one thing that I do want to say is we still are looking for volunteers. If you're listening to this and you have the gift of administration, we could desperately use your help. Social media, we're still looking for somebody to help us with Twitter or Instagram. We also can use some more writers and certainly can use a fundraiser. So even if you do not think you have any quantifiable skills, but you have time and you're interested in learning, we can train you. So email me, Christian@NormandyStories.com. I would love to hear from you. If you can make a donation this week, we have had a couple of people do monthly donations of $25 or $50. One person did it for $100. The monthly donations have been incredible because we have monthly payments, like for editing software that we're having to pay for. And to know that that money is there every month has just been really incredible. So if you can make a donation, awesome. If you can't, if you could share this with some of your friends on social media, tell them to watch our trailer. Our trailer hooks everybody. Watch our trailer. And then, you know, share the film. And then check out NormandyStories.com/screenings and see if you can come see us. I would love to meet you.
Awesome. Well, hey, everyone. Glad you could be here. Thanks for listening to Documentary First, where we believe everyone has a story to tell, and you can be the one to tell it.
Thank you for listening to Documentary First. We really appreciate your partnership with us. We can't do any of this without you. So thank you so much for listening, for donating, and for following along on our journey. If you are able to make a donation this week, we really would appreciate it. We are supported by donors who give us $100 or less, so anything helps. Also, if you're able to share the news about the girl who wore freedom with your friends and family, please do that on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, or email, and sign up for our newsletter at NormandyStories.com. Please go to NormandyStories.com/donate to make a donation today.